Welcome to the second episode of the series where we discuss the Metro games. Today we'll be talking about Metro Last Light, the sequel of Metro 2033. As in the first video, we'll only be discussing the canon ending, as this game has two endings as well. To better understand this video, watch the previous one first. With all that being said, enjoy watching. The game starts 1 year after the events of the last game, 1 year after the bombing of the home of the Dark Ones. Artyom is now a member of the Rangers and is living in D6, which the Order transformed into their base. We are awakened by Khan, who tells Artyom that he spotted a single survivor of the Dark Ones while he was on the surface. He tells us that it's crucial we make peace with this survivor because it was a mistake that we destroyed them. He believes that this final Dark One is the key to the survival of humanity. In a meeting with Miller, Khan tells him about the Dark One, but Miller doesn't see things as he does, so he sends us and his daughter Anna to kill this final Dark One. While we head to the surface, we hear of a ranger called Letznitsky that is missing and that no one knows what happened to him. While we make our way to the surface, Anna keeps calling Artyom Little Rabbit for no apparent reason. This isn't connected to the story in any way, I just found it weird and annoying. After all, Artyom is the furthest thing away from a scared little rabbit, but anyway. We make our way to the Botanical Gardens, the former home of the Dark Ones, and we get to see the destruction we caused because everything has been turned to ash. After a little while, Artyom sees the final surviving Dark One, and it's a child. A primary school Dark One, that's all that's left of an entire species. We try to capture it, but after a game of cat and mouse, we, as well as the Dark One, get captured by the Fourth Reich. We wake up in a prison, and we get to see the obsession for perfection that the Reich has that I mentioned in the last video. Artyom and this other prisoner, who is a soldier of the Red Line, the communists of the Metro, narrowly escape execution and find a way to escape their cells. Pavel, the Red Line soldier, is seemingly very friendly, and Artyom really seems to trust him, even saving him from being hanged by the Nazis. Well, it turns out that Pavel is in fact a high-level communist officer, and after we make our way to the safety of the Red Line, he betrays us, and we end up in captivity again, but this time at the hands of the commies. We get interrogated by the Red Line leader, Maxim Moskvin, and the head of intelligence, General Korbut. Even though Maxim is the official leader of the Red Line, General Korbut has more power than him because he helped Maxim kill his own brother, the former leader of the Red Line, to gain power. Because he is the one who helped him rise to power, he basically has him in his pocket. Remember in the last episode when I said that the Red Line wanted to conquer the Metro Line? Well, before Artyom blew up the Dark Ones, Korbut wanted to domesticate one of them and use it as a weapon against the other lines. So naturally, this last Dark One is of very high importance to him, that's why he sent Pavel after him. After we escape with the help of the son of Maxim, who is strongly against the actions of his father, we learn of a plan that Korbut has, but we don't know exactly the details for now. We make our way out of the communist line, and by absolute chance we meet Andrew the blacksmith. He is on the run from the communists because of their crackdown on smugglers. He is helping other refugees make their way to Hansa from the Red Line and the Fourth Reich. Hansa is the biggest confederation of the Metro Lines. They are more of a trading alliance, even though in the past they fought a war with the Red Line, a war that they won. Andrew the blacksmith helps us get a message to Miller in which we tell him that we are alive and we mean to continue our mission to find the Dark One. He also gifts us this car so that we can reach Venice faster. Venice is a unique station because it's situated on an island in the underground. We manage to get there with the help of a fisherman that we find in an abandoned metro line. In Venice, we also find Pavel that is leading a team of Red Line soldiers to retake the Dark One that is heading to some place called Oktobriskaya. After he tells us this, unfortunately Pavel manages to escape. Luckily, one of the residents of Venice tells us about a ranger outpost located in a church somewhat close nearby. This is not the same church outpost from the first game, so I find it a bit weird that this one is also a church, but fair enough. In order to get there, we must cross a swamp, and after we do this, we have a boss fight with a giant mutated shrimp. Yes, this game introduces the concept of boss fights, and honestly, they are really fun, even though most of them are the same in terms of gameplay. After this, we regroup with the rangers at the church, including Anna, who feels really bad she abandoned us at the botanical gardens. But unfortunately, this reunion doesn't last too long, because Lesnitsky, the ranger that I mentioned earlier, together with a group of redline soldiers, lead an attack on the outpost, an attack that kills everybody except Artyom and Anna, but they take Anna alive, while they leave us for dead. But luckily, we ain't dead yet, so after we make our way through what appears to be an underground, abandoned city, and another boss fight, we make our way to a station within Hansa. Anna is also located at this station, but we also see redline soldiers executing residents of the station because they are infected with some sort of disease. So let's take a detour from the story for a while to understand what is going on. It turns out that the reason Lesnitsky left the Rangers is because he was a redline spy that was sent to D6 to recover a bioweapon. D6 was a war facility before the fallout, and the Russian government was developing a bioweapon based on an Ebola strain there. What is special about this weapon is that it's lethal for a short period of time, and after that it becomes harmless. This means that you can unleash it in a station, for example, wait for everybody to die, and then send in your men to capture it without any losses. It turns out Korbut learned of this weapon, and after the Dark Ones were seemingly destroyed, this was the next best thing in order to help him conquer the whole metro. The reason they unleashed it into this innocent metro station is because they wanted to test it. With all this information in mind, let's get back to the story. After we see the destruction the Red Line caused in the station, we find Anna. She is being held at gunpoint by Lesnitsky, and he says that if we take off our mask, he will let her go. If you don't want to take off your mask, and instead want to shoot him, the same thing happens, and you and Anna are now gasping for air because of the fire that was started by the Red Line to burn the bodies in the base. By a miracle, the two make their way to a Hansa base, but now they are both scared that they might be infected by the bioweapon. Seeing that they might die, they decide to have some spicy time, and in the bad ending we see that this led to a child, but that's irrelevant for now. After they get examined by a doctor, it seems that they are both fine, and Artyom finds Khan again. They head to a place called the River of Fate, that seemingly has supernatural powers, and will transport them to the Dark One's location. Now I don't know exactly how this River of Fate works, because it appears to have the power to transport them back in the past, because we see the moment Artyom destroyed the Dark One's home, but what is clear is that the river actually sends them close to the baby Dark One's location. He is being transported on a train, and after we board it, we finally get our hands on the Dark One. And now I think it's a great time to discuss Artyom's history with the Dark Ones. When Artyom was a little kid, he and a couple of friends managed to open the doors to the station close to the botanical gardens, where the home of the Dark Ones was. They get attacked by monsters, but a Dark One comes and rescues them. Why would a hostile creature save a few human children? Well, because the Dark Ones weren't evil. They were just the next step in evolution. So the first game intentionally makes you believe that the Dark Ones were hostile when they weren't. That's why I said in the last Metro video we will discuss the Metro 2033 ending again. The Dark Ones also have the ability to communicate with humans through psychic ability. So when at the ending of the previous game they said they wanted peace, they really meant it. Because Artyom was the first human they encountered, they viewed him sort of as a chosen one that would unite their species, but in the end he was the reason they almost went extinct. And I say almost because there is a group of them hibernating under D6, so it's possible they were a species created before the war that ended up thriving in the irradiated environment from the surface. Khan also calls them the Last Angels, sent to save them, and in a way he's right, but we'll see that later. The Dark One and Artyom now must make their way to Polis because there is a peace treaty being negotiated between Hansa and the Red Line. But in reality, the Red Line would betray the treaty and release the virus in the whole metro. and this is where the Dark One's ability to show people's thoughts to others comes in handy. So we make a deal with him. We help him get as close to D6 as possible, and he helps us show the real intentions of the Red Line. In order to get to Polis, we must traverse the surface again. And this part of the game was my favorite, because you really begin to form a connection with the Dark One. Artyom even says at one point that he finds it hard to believe that this little guy is so pure, it doesn't even consider violence, because remember, the Dark Ones can read someone's mind, so he knows that we are the ones responsible for the death of his kind. Yet, even so, he doesn't bear any resentment towards us. He even begins to help us and tries to learn more about our civilization, and you can see him during our journey learning new words and even human concepts such as forgiveness if you let Pavel live. He can also see if a person or a beast is hostile, and if it's not, he will ask you not to kill it, because whether Artyom likes it or not, they are part of the same earth together now. Plus, the first time I saw him wearing clothes, I really felt bad for killing them in the first game. Once we make our way to Polis, he reveals to everybody the Red Line's plan, and Moskvin tells everybody the truth. We also learn that the Red Line are on their way to attack D6, so all the Rangers make their way towards the base. When we get there, Miller gives off a really good speech, and this moment really got stuck in my mind. After this, the Red Line attacks, and a fierce battle rages on. They throw everything at us, but as Miller puts it, every Ranger is worth 5 of them. But even so, eventually we get overrun. Before the battle, Miller had rigged the whole base with explosives, and he tells us that if we lose, it is crucial that we blow ourselves up, together with the communists, because if they got their hands on D6, the Metro will surely fall in their grasp. Now, with almost every Ranger dead or wounded, it's Artyom's task to set the explosives to blow. But if you made the right choices during the game, the little Dark One will show up with his brothers and will stop you from doing that and will kill the Red Ones. At the end of the game, we find the fates of our friends. Colonel Miller is now restrained to a wheelchair but becomes the head of security in Polis. Ullman, along with most of the Rangers, died in the battle, and Khan just mysteriously vanished. And this only amplifies the mysterious nature of Khan that we see in the games. The Dark Ones and humanity finally make peace, but they leave because they feel it's in the best interest of both species. The credits then roll, and Metro Last Light is done. But before doing the outro, I really want to praise the soundtrack of this game. To put it simply, it's beautiful. You will hear what I'm talking about in the outro. But with all this said, thank you for watching. If you enjoyed the video, maybe subscribe and leave a like, and I will see you soon with the final video of this series. Goodbye.